Hello and welcome to the Music Smoothie.
Welcome back to the Music Smoothie, or welcome for the first time. We've got a lovely episode for you here today. First off, we've got Olaf.
What up, dude?
And of course, we've got Hipster Pug.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, so this is going to be just a low-key kind of episode. We're gonna chill. We're gonna share some songs with you. We're gonna talk about them. We're gonna have a good time, and that's what it's all about: the graphics. And also, I've seen all good people turn their heads these days. So satisfied, I'm on my way. I know I screwed that up. That's fine. And Olaf has something he'd like to say.
Hello, everybody. It's me, Gay Olaf. I'm going to play you a song by the singer-songwriter called Cutworms. This is called The Ballad of the Texas King. And if you like the Beatles, if you like Daniel Johnson, you're probably going to like this one. And if you don't, then fuck you.
Nothing at all, no love there to find. All dressed down, walking out.
All right, that was Cutworms with the song Battle of the Texas King. So if you're a fan of Daniel Johnson, the Beatles, anything sing-songwriting, you probably like this song. And Les, what do you think?
Yeah, this was a very good song. I really like the really simple laid back structure of it. It took me back. I mean, it really felt like a 60s 70s just a kind of ballady Americana song with, you know, like a lot of like country leaning specifically tendencies, but you know, still has like that folky, like a country folky kind of vibe to it, like definitely that singer songwriter style that was very popular in the mid to late 60s. And I really appreciated that about it. It's definitely my it's right up my alley. And I just love the smooth silky guitars and the soft tapping of the drums. It just all came together beautifully and melted into this wonderful souffle that I have to stick in my mouth as soon as possible.
And the steel pedal. Yep. And Pug, what did you think?
Well, I really liked the Beatles, and this sounded like a Beatles song. So yeah, no, I really enjoyed this. I never heard of this band or this group or this artist, but yeah, no, I really like this this kind of sound, this song, and like Les said already, like the folky sound of it, like it really brings you back to the 60s, the 70s, that kind of feeling that those songs can bring you to with the Beatles, and in some way it makes you feel more comfortable and like everything will be all right kind of feeling with this kind of music. And like I said, the Beatles do that for me too, and this has really much the same vibe. So yeah, a great opener for this podcast.
Yeah, I also enjoy the simplicity, but also like how he goes about doing the melodies, and also just love his voice, you know.
Yeah, his voice is great. Voice.
It sounds so, I would say, like, I don't know the word to say it, but it's a comment. It sounds like your friend could be saying this. He doesn't have like this extraordinary, beautiful, amazing voice, but he just has a great singing voice that sounds like it could be you or your friend singing it. I think it's also amazing. So let me pass the torch to the next guy. I forget. It's Les.
Yeah, you forget this guy. He's not that important. Yeah, I've got a song for you. Are any of you guys familiar with My Asshole?
Oh yeah, I've been there a few times.
No.
No, I tricked you. I set you up. You thought I was gonna say something real. Like, are you guys familiar with this band? No.
Anyway, are you gonna make sound out of it, or
you have deceived me? Make a beautiful you have song deceived me. You played me the fool.
Played you the fool. Everybody plays the fool. All right, I got Ghosts by Nelward. Have either of you heard this song?
No.
Okay. All right, let's give it a listen. It's I guess I could describe it real quick. It's sort of like, because it kind of catches you off guard in that it's kind of like an indie pop song, but it has like glitch hop influences and also like progressive metal influences. And it's a ride. Let me just play it for you.
My man, you starting to sound like Billy right now.
All right. I didn't mean to. I'm excited about the song. I want to tell you how excited I am.
Okay, Billy, let's hear it.
And that was Ghost by Nowword, an art pop artist from Atlanta, Georgia. And what did you think of that, Olaf?
It's a pretty cool song. Kind of sucked ass, but I like the energy and the hype about it. It feels like something I would listen to when I was like 19 at a home party. I don't know if I would listen to this by myself, but it was cool. It was just gave a lot of energy.
Yeah.
Some of that energy I was not a fan of anymore, but yeah, I feel it.
Okay.
But would you, do you fuck with it?
Yeah, I do fuck with it a little bit. I'm going to give it a 10 out of 14.
All right. Fair enough. And Hipster Pug, what'd you think?
It was a musical trip. there were some parts of this song that I really like the beginning and the random glitch things and sounds and stuff that happened. I kind of enjoyed it, but I also had the same feeling as Olaf. Like, I would listen to this when I was 19 or 17 or something, but I probably wouldn't listen to it right now, even though I like this song. But it's a song that I can listen one time and probably will not listen to anymore. But I didn't hate it. It sounds so negative, but no, it's a good song though. But I wouldn't fuck it.
Oh, that's all right. You don't have to. You don't have to actually. Yeah. The song has not consented. All right. I guess it's you up next.
All right. I want to start with a song from Sufjan Stevens, and let me get this right, because he did this projects with some other artists. So this is Sufjan Stevens, Nico Muli, and Bryce Dessner. Bryce Dessner is the guitarist or the drummer from The National, from the indie band. And they made an album called Planetarium back in 2017. It's a pretty long song. I'm warning already. It's like 7 minutes, but I find it really interesting the way this song is built up, and the ending of the song I really like. I also sort of like the lyrics of the song. So if you have time and you can put up the lyrics, I would really recommend it. And I'm just going to share it with you right now and talk a little bit more about it afterwards. Oh, it needs to be another way.
Space.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, the ending is a little bit weird because it's an album that you need to listen like in one run actually. So, but yeah, I chose this song from the album because I really like the experimental sound of it. I really like the build up, and especially the ending is in my opinion really, really good, and almost like nothing like the rest of the whole song. It's almost going back to basic, like very well, not calm, but calmer than the rest of the song. Yeah, and like I said, it's actually an album that you should listen in one run. It's great overall, and I really recommend some other songs to listen to. Pluto is also a really good song. What if you want to listen to one or more two more songs of this album, then definitely listen to this song too, because it's really special too. But what did you think of it, Olaf?
Yep.
Yeah. All right. what did you think of the song?
Sound like Osborne. That was Ozzy Osborne.
Okay.
That's yeah. Ozzy Osborne. That's why.
Sorry.
I don't know. I don't think. Very okay. Long. Very long.
Yeah,
song.
No, it's a very long song. I admit that. Yeah,
sound like yeah, Black Sabbath, but Black Sabbath Smooth. That was pretty cool. I could play that sometime in the car.
Okay, all right.
It was pretty chill.
All right.
But it was going through those stages. It was not just
yeah.
Just went through a lot of stuff that I had to. Okay, now this song is doing this or that. It felt like it was like three or four songs in one.
Yeah, no, this is true. It's like I said, it's very experimental in especially in the beginning, and with all the sounds and all the things that's going on, and the vocals and the it's not called autotune, but with the I don't know the name of it, but yeah, I think if I can give
in the defense of autotune, what do you get autotune? I think autotune is amazing. I think it's really cool. You can make cool sound with autotune. A lot of people hate on it.
Oh, yeah.
But I think autotune is completely fine. You can make a lot of good songs with autotune.
There are songs that...
are songs that just... I mean, you don't have to be a good singer to make a good song with autotune, but a great singer and make a good song with autotune. Autotune is just a cool tool.
Yeah, and I think there are some songs, and maybe this is not smart to say, but there are some songs that got better by autotune or by the use of autotune from the artist that uses it.
I use all my songs, and I'm not good, but I would say that I'm a pretty it's unnecessary. It's like, oh, you tune a guitar. Well, I tune my thing singing. I think autotune is fine. I don't hate it at all.
Okay.
I think it's fine when it's used deliberately, when it's used intentionally to... as an instrument, you know, like if you're... it's an added element to a song, you know, like if it's being used like frivolously by people who don't understand it, or people who, you know, are just like, I feel like, but I've talked with Billy about this. I feel like there's many levels of auto-tuning. Like there's just, you know, the touch up to, you know, like improve vocal performance, which, you know, like even the best artists, you know, the best singers in the world, you know, have their voices touched up like that. Just, and that's right. That's auto-tuning. Also, auto-tuning is like the very performative, like turned up all the way, very you know, like the it alters the,
let's say for example T-Pain, the obvious to talk when it comes to autotune. T-Pain is actually an amazing singer on his own without autotune. He's a good singer. He just used autotune as a tool
on the podcast at one point.
So he just used it as like a tool to make a difference. Sound Cher used autotune back in the days.
I don't hate autotune.
I don't hate autotune at all. I don't get why people like this artist uses autotune. Every song they ever made is bullshit. Fuck it. Just use autotune if you want to use it.
Of course. I mean, like I said, there are bands and there are indie groups. I think maybe I'm wrong, but there are a couple of songs by Francis in the Lights and Bon Iver who use autotune for their songs, and it's really good. I mean, it makes the song really good, and it makes the song even more enjoyable. And it would be enjoyable without autotune probably, but because of the autotune, it gives an extra layer of how can I say it? Like interest in the vocals for that song, and I think that's great, and that's the best way to use autotune.
There are different ways to use autotune. You can use autotune to just, you know, subtly adjust the pitch to make something sound better, but, you know, to the average ear it won't sound like autotune. And you can use it in an extreme way, like T-Pain, where the whole sound is autotune, like you know, like that.
Yeah.
And it's just two different ways to use one tool. I have no issues with it. I love autotune. I think autotune is amazing.
Kanye also uses it a lot too.
Kanye West did. I don't know, with his latest album maybe too, but I haven't listened to it a lot. But what is the title of the album from Kanye West? The Dark Twisted Fantasy or something?
Oh yeah,
Yeah.
Oh man, that's beautiful. Amazing. Yeah. That's really amazing.
Yeah, that's
but
a great
because
album.
Of the autotune, it's
I
still, even though Kanye West might be a crazy man, his music is pure genius at some points. And the way he makes music
the art
is
from the artist with Kanye.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was gonna say. I think Kanye West has given us the ultimate task of separating the art from the artist.
Yeah, definitely.
Which is very hard.
Yeah,
but
right now it's very, very hard. But
but it's not so hard when it comes to bands like The Lost Prophets. I don't think anyone will listen to The Lost Prophets anymore, considering what happened.
And you can't. They were taken off of everything. YouTube, Spotify, all the big stuff.
I used to listen to some songs in the mid 2000s. I used to listen to a lot of like Lost Prophet songs, but I was also a kid at the time, so don't judge me too hard on that. We should make an episode about separating the art from the artist.
Yeah.
Like, would you stop listening to Foo Fighters? Foo Fighters is a great band. Dave Grohl, I love that fucking guy. But do you know what they did in the early 2000s, late 90s?
What's that?
They were AIDS denialists. They were doing like fundraisers for a thing called Alive and Well, I think it was called. That was people that was diagnosed with AIDS and who just denied that AIDS was real. And Foo Fighters were just on board. They did not believe that AIDS was real. They made, they collected a lot of money and gave in to these AIDS denialist groups, which ended up killing about I don't know, like 20 kids and
wow,
a few adults.
Wow.
They were really into the AIDS denialism in the early 2000s. No one really talks about that. And they don't even talk about that anymore. But if you go back to, if you go to the back machine on Google, whatever it's called, you can find that they used a donation button on their website and stuff in the early 2000s.
And, oh, wow. This is weird.
Yeah, they did not believe that AIDS was real. They thought that people are just dying of AIDS because of the medicine. It, basically anti-vaxxer stuff.
All right. Okay. Wow. I never knew that about the band, so.
Yeah, they kind of hit it since when everyone in the organization that they supported died from AIDS. They just kind of, oh, maybe we did something wrong. But they never apologized or said anything. They just tried to wipe it under the rug and pretend that it never happened.
Mm.
Well, all right, who's up next? It's me?
Oh, oh, God. No, I want to know what Lost thinks of the song.
Oh, sorry.
It's very important to know.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Les, what did you think of the song?
Yeah,
it's been a while.
You know, I liked the song. It was kind of a wild ride. Yeah, like I wasn't expecting how prevalent the auto-tune was going to be in it. Like it definitely took on like an added layer to the song. It definitely took it to a different place that it obviously wouldn't have gone to otherwise. So it's interesting for that. I did like the changes. I thought that they were gradual enough that it wasn't like jarring or anything. But you know, like the song felt very very spread out, very deliberate, very, you know, it's got a good chance to you know, to put its feet up, you know, I liked it. I wouldn't say that I loved it, but it was interesting.
Okay, well, all right. I really forgot who. I think Olaf, right?
Yes, Olaf's next.
Yes. Okay. Go ahead. All right,
see. Let's see what I got for you. I got Palace Station by a band called Melody Club. It's a Swedish band that made really fun pop music in the early 2000s. But I don't know what happened to them. They just disappeared. But here's Palace Station.
Emotion.
All right, that was Melody Club with Palace Station. And let's see, Hipster Pug, what did you think about that song?
I really, really like this. It really brought me back to the early 2000s. It's such a nostalgia thing, but I love the sound of it. I love the effects of the music. I love the song itself. It's super, super happy. And it was a really great song. I never heard this song before, but like I said, it really brought back memories of the early 2000s and stuff like that. I'm definitely going to listen to this song again.
Yeah, this song defined the early 2000s for me because that was a very popular band in Sweden during that time. And they had a lot of songs, but this one was probably the best one, I think. And let's see, Laz, what did you think?
Yeah, this definitely gave me like a late 90s, early 2000s vibe. I could see this being on the soundtrack of the hit Brendan Fraser film Blast from the Past. Which
Blast I'm sure in my ass? You know about
because you blast from your ass.
Blast in my ass, yeah. This was actually in a lot of movies, Swedish movies,
was it really?
From that time. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Especially when the song Slim, like 2000, I don't know, 2001.
I think I saw 2002 on the Spotify page, but.
Okay.
2002 maybe.
Okay.
It was in the hit movie Slim Susie, which is a great movie. If you have an opportunity to watch it, do it.
Slim Susie?
Swedish movies. Slim Susie.
Okay.
Great movie.
What is the movie about?
Haven't seen it.
It's just about a small town. I don't want to. I can't really tell you what it's about.
Okay.
But I'm spoiling it.
Okay. All right. No, then I'm going to watch it. Just
no. Susie is, you know, this girl and her brother moves away to Stockholm, and then he learns that Susie is missing, so he comes back to his small hometown, and everyone's just acting weird, trying to find his sister, and then yeah, this song is part of that movie.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the town keeps getting smaller and smaller, and soon Susie's skeleton is crushed.
No.
That doesn't happen. Okay.
It's just that the whole town is conspiring. It's kind of like Hot Fuzz, if you've seen that movie.
Oh, yeah.
Hot Fuzz. Oh, yeah, I love that movie.
Hot Fuzz, yeah.
But this came out before Hot Fuzz.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
I guess.
Pass it on to the next.
Passing it on. Pass it on to this guy. All right. I got another song for you. I got a little ditty or two. Okay. This is. My Body's a Zombie for You by Dead Man's Bones. And I'll tell you more about it after.
Thank you.
that was My Body's a Zombie for You by Dead Man's Bones, and featuring the Silver Lake Conservatory of Music Children's Choir. And that band is a dark folk rock duo from Los Angeles, consisting of Ryan Gosling and Zach Shields. And yes, it's that Ryan Gosling. And what did you think of it, Hipster Pug?
Again, I really like this song. It was super interesting, the way that it was built up and the flow of the whole song. The choir was pretty interesting too. And I started following the lyrics while the song was playing. And even though the lyrics were not amazing, I really enjoyed the lyrics with the song and with the instruments and the sound and everything. It really fits together. And it's funny that you say that it's from Ryan Gosling, because I never imagined him making a song like this.
Yeah, that's fair. And Olaf, what did you think?
I just know that Ryan Gosling won't eat his cereal. I liked it. It was, I don't know, had I been in another mood, I probably would have a religious experience with this one. There's something about a choir kids just singing. But not today. I'm going to give it I fuck with it, but I'm also going to give it a 13 out of 10. 10 out of 13.
All right.
I'm also going to give it the Olaf certified banger.
Okay. Sounds good. And I guess it's back to Pug.
It's my turn, I guess, right? Or no? I'm choosing for a more less experimental song than the last song, and a bit shorter too. I found out today that Chiosmos released a new album or new EP. Chiosmos is a group of Oliver Arnold and I forgot his name. Let me see if I can find it very, very quick. Let me see. Oh yeah, I hope I pronounced this right, but Janus Rasmussen. It's a more electronic group or duo that makes songs. I know Oliver Arnold more from his neoclassical music, what I absolutely love and really recommend to everybody who's into piano music and classical music. And they released this song, I think, today. So I heard it maybe 2 times, but I'm already fell in love with it. And I'm more than happy to share it with all of you. So, give me a second. Yes, all right, here we go. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you. All right, I forgot to tell you the title of this song, but it was called Thought, and it was made by Chiasmos. What I really like about this song is also the fact that it's really like the Oliver Arnold sound, the piano, the strings that you hear in this song. And again, in my opinion, it goes very well with electronical sound that's happening, and the beat and the drums and everything that's happening, but you still focusing on that piano and on those strings that you hear. And again, that is really specific, like the Oliver Arnold's kind of sound for me, especially if you're listening to, like, one of the songs is called Doria, where this is very clear, where it is only strings and piano, but it's so beautifully done and so well done. And there's a lot of more songs that I really recommend from him, but that was what it made special for me, this song. And I'm really curious to think or to know what you think of it, Olaf. Oh wait,
I really like it.
Less.
It's
oh
great,
sorry.
Great. Oh okay,
yeah, you're back. Yes.
Hey, you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Is it me? Am I gonna?
Yes,
we hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you.
All good.
I really like this song. The sound like almost like, which is my favorite genres of all time, and also there's Oliver Arnold's in the song, which is nice, not like me. Fuck with this a lot. It's got a 10, rare 10 out of 10 from,
and it's the best it can be.
Wow.
All right, really, really nice to hear that. Les, what did you think of it?
Yeah, I thought this was really good. I hadn't heard any of that I know of. I hadn't heard any of Arnold's work before, but I thought this was very good. It was beautiful and lilting. It had a very It had a very Nordic quality to it that I could really appreciate. It just sounded very serene and peaceful and beautiful. It unfolded like a beautiful necklace or a scarf or something. I don't know. The poetry is escaping me. Anyway, I like the song.
Yeah, no, it was beautiful poetry. I you know, the one thing that I'm super surprised about, and what I'm always fall in love with is the music from Iceland and the artists from there, because I don't know what it is, but it has to be something magical there, because there's so many talents coming from Iceland, and they are all great in the like neoclassical genre and the piano and the stuff like that, and there's also some indie slash pop groups like Sigur Rós. We talked a little bit about it beforehand,
best band of all time,
with Olaf about it. Yeah it's pure magic, and I really really wonder what it is, but Iceland has to be some magical place or something, because it's wonderful what kind of talent is coming from that country.
No, the only reason why it's so boring that the people had nothing else.
Don't break my illusion now.
Have you ever heard a band called Rablir?
No, I don't think so.
It's a stupid punk band from the 70s, and they're also pretty good.
Really? Okay, I'm definitely want to listen to that then.
Okay. Interesting. All right, I guess it's back to you, Olaf.
What's yes.
your next song?
Oh, I might take a guess. No, I'm not going to do that. My next song is going to be Skibidi Toilet. I'm going to play Skibidi Toilet.
I hate that.
For 10 hours.
The day that I've been waiting for.
That will be hell.
That will be hell. That's putting it mildly.
All right, I'm gonna play a Swedish house song called TRT by Savage Goals and Duster. I think it's called pronounced Duster. It's Duster maybe. This came out in 2010, I think, 2011, something like that, and it's Swedish house music.
I don't.
That was TRT by Savage Goals and Dowser. It's a house song released in 2010-11, somewhere around that period of time. It's a homage to the 90s house rave scene, I think. It's a pretty good song, in my opinion. And what did you think, Lass?
Yeah, it's funny. I don't listen to much house music because, honestly, it reminds me of when I was a kid, my mom would take me into a lot of, like, boutique stores in the mall, and they would always be blasting house music, and we'd just be sitting there, or I'd be sitting there, you know, for hours while she shopped, and it's linked to that trauma for me. But as for this...
sitting down is very traumatic. I'm sorry.
Sitting down is very traumatic. Yeah, well, I appreciate the sentiment. but anyway, this song... I thought it was it stayed dynamic enough and compelling, and it had little change-ups that really kept it compelling for me. From what I've heard, some house music runs the risk of just sounding samey over a long period of time, and then it's like, you know, like, okay, when's this song gonna end? But this one, you know, it was good. It didn't do that. It definitely changed things up. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. You know what I'm saying?
Did you know that swing can also mean something like a playground where kids are swinging? Did you know that? On a swing set? Ever heard of this shit? Swing set? There's some new shit they came up with. It's a woke mob. They made up this called swing set. Trying to like groom our kids into not listening to swing music.
Well, then that's a good cause, because we should all be listening to swing music.
All right.
So,
Punk.
Yeah.
1 second.
Hello. Like this.
All right, go ahead. Now, I accidentally unplugged my headphones.
I really like this song. It reminds me, like, back in the... I think it was back in the 90s and stuff, like you said. This kind of music was really big in the Netherlands. I'm not a big house guy or fan of this music, but I sometimes can enjoy a song like this just because I don't listen to this very often. So I kind of enjoyed this song, and really reminds me of like the Dutch versions and the Dutch house music that we got here in the 90s and the early 2000s and stuff like that. So it's another nostalgia trip for me. Like I said, I'm not really into house music or stuff like that, but it can be fun at some points, and I enjoyed this song.
Hell yeah. And let me pass it back to my main man, Pug. I think. Is it
No, I think it's less. Almost.
All I wanted was to be your main man.
Зато уютно умирать. Эмалированное судно.
right. That was Sudno by Molchat Doma, meaning houses are silent. And that is a Belarusian band. And what do you think of that, Olaf?
That song is over two.
Yeah, I just realized that after playing it, I was like, fuck, this is way too popular. Why the fuck didn't I notice this earlier? I was just like, what?
Yeah, I love this band. It's a Belarusian pop, punk, and according to my ex-girlfriend, who was Russian, this thing is about this place is not a good place to live, but it's a good place to sing out. It has all the elements of music that I like, but it's 250 million plays. There's 10 million. You overshot.
Actually, it's 254 million.
Yeah.
I know. I screwed up. I thought I checked the... It's because I thought I checked the listen count earlier that I didn't check again. And then I ended up just like playing it. And then I was looking at it while the song was playing. And I was like, oh, fuck, this is way over our limit.
That is. That's way over.
But by then it was too late.
Something else that I have something that you that might not be over the limit. That's in the same era. And also Eastern Bloc that you can play instead.
Oh, okay.
Well, I don't
know. Well, before we do anything else, let's see what Hipster Pug thought of the song, if he's heard it before, if he hasn't.
Surprisingly, I never heard this song before. but also, this is going to sound mean, but I didn't miss a lot. I really don't like this. there's not much to say. It was a short song. That's good. And I get that people like this this music, but I'm not really into this kind of music or this kind of genre of Bulgaria pop and stuff like that.
Okay, fair enough. And then I guess it's back to you, Pug. Are we doing a fourth round, or are we closing it out?
I can do another song if you also want to do. I still have some songs left that I happy to share it. So.
Okay. Well, it depends on Olaf. Then. Olaf? Olaf, you there? Can't hear you. Oh.
Heard something, but...
He got so mad that I accidentally played a song with 264 million plays that he...
he just moved away. He's like, I'm done with this. Too much. I hate him. I'm never going to be on this podcast again. Only because he played a song with 250 million plays.
No, my internet is struggling now for some reason. It usually doesn't, but... Right now, it's like, sorry.
Oh, good, man. It happens.
So,
happened to me on the last trip post episode.
Are we doing one more round, or is this like the final song?
Olaf, it's up to you.
Yeah, let's do a final song. And then a bonus song, because you did the 250 million one song.
All right. Then I'm going to do the final song. Let me get it. Where was it? I think it's, it's this one. All right. I chose another more neoclassical song. I've seen this woman live a couple of weeks ago in Rotterdam, where they do a lot of neoclassical concerts in that, is it called a venue, like the place where they do concerts and stuff like that? What was it, what I wanted to say? Oh yeah, and I saw her live, and it was very amazing to see her live and playing the songs, and I never heard of her before. Her name is Alexandra Alexandra Streliski, and I think she is from Canada. And yeah, no, it was a magical experience to see her live and playing her songs. And I often don't listen to too many songs of an artist that I don't know before I go to a concert, and I just want to be surprised by that artist. And with her, I was really surprised, and I really enjoyed it. And I really hope you like it too. So this is going to be my final song for the podcast this evening. And it's called, Burnout Fugue or something like that. So I hope I pronounced that right. Here we go. Right. I chose this song because it's very short, but also because I really enjoy the way it repeats, and it gets more it gets bigger at the end, and it gets more energy and more power at the end. What I really, really love about this song. Again, I really recommend to listen more of her music. It's really amazing. And if you ever have the opportunity to see her live, go see her live, because it's an experience that you don't want to miss. Lass, what did you think of it?
I thought it was delightful. It's the beautiful piano work. And just very minimal, the same like a neoclassical kind of energy that are usually in songs that you bring. But I really liked it.
Sorry for bringing always neoclassical music.
No, it's all right. It's okay. If not you, who?
Yeah, that's true. And that rhymes. Poetry.
So yeah, I thought it was a pretty neat track.
All right. Happy to hear this. Wow. Olaf, what did you think of it?
It's a pretty beautiful song. Really liked it. Made me wanna like dance ballet or whatever.
Yeah, like, I saw it.
Yeah. It just filled me up with like emotions that I can't put words into, but you know, it just made me wanna express myself in some sort of way to go along with it. It was very, very nice, and yeah, it did something to me that I really enjoyed. Okay. So I'm gonna give this a 10 out of 11.
Wow, good. Nice.
Damn, you're giving Pug all these perfect scores.
That's not a perfect score. That's a 10 out of 10 is a perfect score. That's 10 out of 11.
All right. I think there was a bonus song. I don't know which song that's going to be, but I'm really curious right now.
A bonus song.
Yeah, okay. I'm gonna show. Yeah, that's me gonna play the bonus song.
Technically, since I brought the song that was over, shouldn't I have to bring the bonus song?
No, that's me. Sucked ass.
Happy you tell it.
Alright, have you heard this song?
Alright, well, another one. Please do another Arctic song. Oh no. That's
you're gonna love this song. Come on.
We'll be right back.
That was a gay song by Boris Suck Me Off, also known as Suck More Dickus. What did you think, Les?
I think that was actually the Manhattan Transfer by Saber Pulse. And what did I think of it, Les? Well, I thought of it. It was pretty good.
Yeah, to be honest, Boris Sucked Me Off kind of fell off, to be honest.
Yeah.
Mid. Kind of mid.
Fell off on account of mid. Yeah. But yeah, I liked this. It was fun. I don't know why it's happening, but it's my life now, and I have to accept that.
It helps with your libido. It helps with your taxes. You know, it does everything that you need it to do.
All right.
And also, Hipster Pug, what did you think about this song by Suck More Dickus?
I think it was a great, great song. No, I'd say it's a fun chip tune. And Boris knows how to make music.
Well, we all know Boris, right?
Oh yeah, Boris. Good old Boris. with his chiptune music.
Yeah. Boris Sucked Me Off. He's like the inventor of chiptune. We love Boris Sucked Me Off.
But who is Suck More Dickus? Is that his brother? Or his cousin?
Suck More Dickus, that's just a guy. He used to be
just a random guy who is Boris's friend.
He used to be the assistant dolly grip on Jaws 3. That's why we love him so much.
But weren't we all the assistant dolly grips on Jaws 3?
Actually, this is true. You can look this up. The actual assistant dolly grip on Jaws 3, actually called Jaws 3D, was Kit Duncan. I know this. So if you look it up, the assistant dolly grip on Jaws 3D was Kit Duncan. And that's his only IMDb page that he has.
Okay.
What a great ending again.
Speaking of Kit Duncan, one time when I was in America, me and my girlfriend, we were driving the car and it was raining really bad, and we got a flat tire, and you know, we had to like go to the side of the road, and another car just stopped and we couldn't really see his face. He had like a hoodie on because it was raining so bad. It was pouring, like it was like spears coming down from heaven. And he helped us change his tires and didn't say anything. Then he left.
Was this Kit Duncan or not?
I don't know if that was Kit Duncan, but I'd like to think it was.
I hope it was for you. Oh my god. Didn't he tell about his Jaws 3D experience then?
He didn't say anything. He's a very humble man. The late great Kit Duncan.
I don't know who that
is. He's the assistant dollar grip on Jaws 3D. Uncultured swine.
I guess so.
Oh man. If he wasn't working on a movie, it was never going to be a success. Thanks for him, it was a success.
Yeah, he didn't do anything, but I don't know what do you do as an assistant dollar grip?
No idea.
You must but survive. Man, grip your own dollar.
He made sure the movie was great.
Yeah.
We couldn't do it without him.
It's not even a
good movie. And he changed your tire when you were in America. Really?
All right, well, look this up. Here, I'm going to send you a link of IMDb, okay. Kit Duncan.
Kit Duncan. The... All right, I'm going to search for it right now. Yep, Joss Whedon, right, Cameron Electrical what? Department. I really wonder what happened to him.
I really want to know how this is related to music.
Well, it's all thanks to Boris, so...
It's next to Boris suck me off.
Well, it says here Kit Duncan is known for Jaws 3D.
Great. Someone's got to be known for it.
Oh my god. Yeah, and what a movie it was. Have you ever seen Jaws?
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen a single Jaws.
No, movie. Me neither. I have no idea if it's any good.
It's not.
It's culturally significant, but it's not good, I don't think.
No, I think it's one of the worst movies made, right? It's 3D.
Did you ever see the movie Pariah or Piranha, whatever it's called, 3D?
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure if I saw the 3D version, but I saw it. I saw the movie at some point. You know which movie I saw when I was a kid? It was Spy Kids, the movie 3D.
With Sharkboy and fucking Lava Bitch or whatever it's called.
No, this was, I think it was called Spy Kids or something like that. And it was really weird 3D animations and stuff like that.
They're also culturally significant, but they're not good movies.
Oh no, definitely not. There was this weird area of 3D movies that it was very popular and nobody gives a care about it anymore now. And I think they still do 3D at some movies.
Yeah, but now we have, I think it started with like Avatar, the Blue Boys Avatar, not Airbender Avatar.
Okay,
The 3D at the cinema with the new type of 3D, but... I went to a movie, I think it was Jurassic Park, with the, you know, the red and the blue, whatever, type 3D glasses.
Yeah.
Plastic.
Yeah.
Awful. Not a good experience.
Yeah.
At all. Oh, no. And I was like 5 years old. Anything was good. Not that. I was enjoying Bananas in Pajamas, watching that on TV every morning. Did not like that movie. That kind of tells you how bad it was.
Yeah, I remember that program too. And that was weird.
Yeah, it was not good, but...
No.
That show was this is the shit.
But not in pyjamas. Oh, man. How did we get here?
Les, did you have Vanessa in Pajamas in America?
No, I don't think so.
It's a very Europe thing, I guess.
Okay. I think it was British. I'm not sure. But it's a show about... There's two bananas. They're called B1 and B2. And they live in this big house. They have some... There are like three bears that also live there. And
there was a whole cast of characters. Wait, I'm gonna...
And all they wanted to do was eat jelly and hug them. Was basically like Teletubbies, but a little less like stupid. Teletubbies was really stupid.
I found something wonderful. Can I share it?
All right, go ahead.
All right.
Wait. I don't know what this is. But it's going to be horrible, probably.
That was the theme song. Theme song to Bananas in Pajamas. And this is what they looked like.
I'm trying to find if I can find something about the characters, but
it's kind of creepy.
It is. I mean, as is every fucking. Did you know? Bananas in Pajamas is Australian. I thought it was British. Or
really?
Bananas in Pajamas is an Australian children's TV television series. The first aired on July 20th, 1992 on ABC.
Okay.
Let's see. The main characters are two anthropomorphic bananas named B1 and B2. Other characters include the three teddy bears, Amy, Lulu, and Morgan, and Rat in a Hat. The bananas, the teddies, and Rat in a Hat all live in the same neighborhood called Cul-de-sac. Cuddles Avenue. The bananas live next to the beach and serve as beach patrol. The teddies live next to and look after the park. Rat in the Hat works and lives in the community store. The characters enjoy eating munchy honey cakes and yellow jelly. That's about it. It's not important at all. I'm going to go take a piss and a poo.
To be honest, the Kid Duncan story was better, but this was okay.
Fucking love Kid Duncan, though. Can we just take a moment of silence for the late
Kid Duncan? Yeah,
that's important. Can we call this
the man, the legend,
Duncan, the Kid Duncan smoothie? Respect to Kid Duncan
and his work on the Jaws 3D.
Without Kid Duncan, we wouldn't have Jaws 3D. The only Jaws movie that no one remembers, and he didn't do anything.
All right, I guess. I guess we'll have to we'll call the episode there. This has been the Music Smoothie. Hope you guys had a great time. We've had Olaf, and we've had Hipster Pug.
Yes, yes, yes.
Oh, was there anything either of you guys wanted to plug before you go?
Yeah, I want to plug my butthole. But I'm gonna do it after I go.
All right, sounds good.
No, I'm good.
You don't want to be associated with Olaf's butthole.
No, I'd rather not.
I'm gonna plug Jaws 3D. Check it out. As a great dolly grip assistant.
All right, man.
Oh.
And check out Chow Lin on Spotify. Great band. It's me.
Oh, and just check Hipster Perk on Spotify too, then.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes. No. All right. And that was our latest episode of the Music Smoothie. Hope you enjoyed that blend. And if you like what we do and would like us to record consistently, we're currently trying to record weekly. Consider donating to us on Patreon at The Music Smoothie, and follow us on Twitter at TMusicSmoothie, and we're available on Instagram and Facebook at just The Music Smoothie. All the music we use is fair use under the media criticism clause of fair use,
And if you like the music we listen to but don't always have time to listen to the episode, our playlist is available on Spotify. Just type in the Music Smoothie, and you'll be able to find all the music we play. All right. That's all the music that's available on Spotify, at least. Not all of it is. I hope you guys had a great time. And have a good one. Day, morning, evening, night. Times in other dimensions as well. Yeah. All right. See ya.